You're listening to the audio production of 10 Principles for Studying Your Bible by Charles F. Stanley, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Stephen Bowlby.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it, for then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Introduction. Built on the Rock. When the rain stopped and the sun reemerged, the family returned home to survey the damage. It was all destroyed, everything from the front porch to the garage out back. The house had been built too close to the beach, and there was no way it could remain standing after taking a direct hit from a powerful hurricane. But that had not been a consideration months earlier during the home's construction. On September 15, 1999, Hurricane Floyd trained its eye on North Carolina's coast, and in particular, its barrier islands. At first, weather forecasters downplayed the storm's power, saying it had lost strength and was only a Category 2. Days earlier, the same coastline had been pounded by Hurricane Dennis that packed torrential rains and 70-mile-per-hour winds. 10 days later, Hurricane Floyd delivered a final blow to many of the homes in its path. Up till the last moment, experts had continued to report that there was nothing to be concerned about except additional heavy rain and moderate flooding. But their estimate was wrong. In fact, it was dead wrong. After it left Florida, Floyd regained some of its original strength while crossing over the warm waters of the Atlantic Ocean. When it made landfall in North Carolina, it was a major Category 3 storm and caused major flooding, loss of life, and miles of destruction that stretched inland. Homes on the barrier island were leveled to the point of being unrecognizable. It was the worst natural disaster in North Carolina's history. 2.5 months earlier, in mid-June, with the sun beaming down on the vacationers, no one saw this coming. I want to use this example to underscore a very important lesson that we find in Scripture. It is one that Jesus taught his disciples, and I believe it is crucial to living a successful Christian life. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them may be compared to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and slammed against the house. And yet, it did not fall, for it had been founded on the rock. Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and slammed against that house. And it fell, and great was its fall. When Jesus had finished these words, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority, and not as their scribes. Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 29. The disciples understood the story, but needed help with the lesson of the parable. Weather changes in the region were not uncommon. Palestine was known to experience sudden strong storms. Rains could be so fierce that dusty, dry gullies would become torrents, sweeping away anything in their path. The example of two people building houses on different locations is perfect for what we are about to study. The man who built his house on the sand saw it fall in destruction. No matter how great the construction, the foundation was not built on solid ground. It was constructed on sand, something that can erode quickly when the storms of life come. Another man built his house on a rock foundation. Therefore, when the rain beat hard against it, it withstood the pressure. When a cruel and intense wind began to blow, it was not shaken. And when the floodwaters rose, it was not washed away because its foundation was anchored to the rock. There is no question about which foundation is stronger. When we build our lives on the truth of God's Word, we are building on an eternal foundation that cannot be destroyed. We are building on the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ. Those who have never given their lives to Him are living on a sandy shoreline, one that is sure to wash away. While physical storms may not always inflict great pain or suffering, emotional and mental storms do. However, you do not have to go through life wondering if the next storm will be the one that washes your life out to sea. God has an answer for your greatest need, and it is found in the study of His Word. This is your sure foundation. As you open the Bible, ask Him to reveal Himself to you, and then to teach you more about His love every day. Your life will be changed, and you will be blessed far beyond what you can imagine, because you have built your life on an unshakable foundation, the Lord Jesus Christ. Chapter 1. Come. Moses lifted his eyes and saw the flames in the distance. Something was burning on the side of the mountain, something unlike anything he'd ever seen. He watched it, at first with curiosity, but then with wonder. It was a consuming fire, yet the bush that contained the flame was not destroyed. For years, he had shepherded his father-in-law's flocks, and on occasion noticed fires burning in the distance. But this one was different. It was more than a campfire of a neighboring shepherd. This fire burned with intensity and contained no hint of going out. Moses stood and watched this sight. Maybe he continued to move the flock from one place to another, noting that the fire was just as powerful in the evening as it had been in the first part of the day. Finally, he could wait no longer. He said, "I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, and discover why the bush is not burned up." Exodus chapter 3, verse 3. God has a divine purpose resting behind events in life. Nothing is coincidental. The bush burned because He wanted to gain Moses' attention. He wanted him to draw near. Sometimes, His purpose for our lives is very clear. Sometimes it is not. It can appear to be very mysterious, but it never is to God. We may find ourselves asking, "God, what are you doing?" Certainly, Moses was in wonder over the sight of the burning bush, and more than likely, he wanted to know why it was not consumed. Have you ever wondered why God allows certain challenges, events, and trials to take place? Most of us have. We encounter a serious problem and immediately are tempted to feel hopeless. Other times, when we sense a change, we may actually welcome it. We find ourselves longing to have His wisdom. But how do we gain this? There is only one place, and that is in the company of God. God drew Moses to Himself. He knew exactly how His future deliverer would respond, and He knows how we will respond when He calls to us. When the Lord saw that Moses turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Verse 4. 40 years of living in a vast wilderness changed Moses. God had used the experience to prepare him for service. There probably was a time when he would not have noticed the flame that burned on the side of God's holy mountain. But this was no longer the case. God was drawing him close to Himself. How does He draw you and me close to Himself? Often, it is in the same way, but the circumstances are different. He may allow us to experience a challenge that is much greater than our ability to handle it. Moses spent 40 years in a wilderness without the comforts that he once knew in Egypt. But each day was a day that God used to shape his life and prepare him for what he would do in the future. Each step he took was a step closer to becoming the man God created him to be. He may set up a scenario to gain our attention. Moses saw a bush that was in full blaze, yet it was not destroyed. It definitely caught his eye, and he wondered how this could be happening. You may find yourself in a situation that is nothing like the one Moses saw unfold before him. It could be something as simple as standing in line at the grocery store and suddenly becoming aware of God's awesome love. Or you may be at home reading your morning devotional, and suddenly you know God wants to speak to you about an incident or challenge that you have encountered. How do you know this? The words written on the page of your devotional book or Bible almost leap off. It is as if they are underlined, and you are stopped by what you have read. Regardless of how God draws us near, our response should be this: Lord, I am here. Speak to me and show me what you want to teach me. He may just want you to worship him for a few minutes as you step away from the hurried pace of our world. Or he may want you to draw even closer through the study of his word. This is where we uncover the deeper things of God, his nature, characteristics, and way. You cannot truly know God until you take time to read and study the Bible. Every question you have is answered within its pages. There is nothing you can think of that God has not thought of before you and fully explained in the text of his word. God loves you so much that he wants you to have his very best, but you cannot experience this outside of knowing him. When you spend time studying his word, you begin to realize that you are gaining the knowledge you need for a lifetime of devotion to him. He also provides the wisdom you need for every circumstance of life. He withholds nothing. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Psalm 84, verse 11. But you cannot discover God's will for your life or the situation that you are in apart from spending time with him. This includes studying his word with a notepad and an open heart. I want to know you, Lord. When Moses stepped into God's presence for the first time, an intimate relationship began to form between him and the Lord. At the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3, we read that Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God, verse 6. However, by Exodus chapter 33, there is an entirely different account of their meetings. Verse 11 states, "The Lord used to speak to Moses face to face, just as a man speaks to his friend." Moses drew near to God and became so involved with him that he wanted to learn his ways. And this made the difference in his life and in the relationship he had with the Lord. Often I ask people if they study their Bibles, especially when they're seeking counsel about an issue that is very clearly outlined in God's Word. I'm always surprised at the number of times I hear, "I try, but it is too hard to understand. I just leave the preaching and the studying up to you. I try to listen on Sundays." There is nothing difficult about reading God's Word. If you are having trouble, it could be the result of something that needs to be addressed, such as a lack of faith in God or some unconfessed sin. When we doubt his word to us, we will not have the tools we need to see the circumstances of life clearly. I've counseled people and reminded them of God's promises for a certain situation. Before I could finish my sentence, they began talking, and usually their sentence began with, "but," and then they went on to give one excuse after another as to why God would not work on their behalf. This is what I mean by a lack of faith. God's love for us is everlasting. When you turn and come to him, he will not cast you away. Moses lived on the backside of the desert for 40 years. He probably thought no one cared for him, but God did. He loved Moses with an everlasting love. This is the same love he has for you and me. Moses, however, did not have the Holy Spirit or the Word of God to guide him. He had to rely on entering into God's presence and listening for his instruction. Without the Holy Spirit, we do not have the ability to comprehend God's truth. Yet the moment we surrender our lives to him, he pours out his truth to us in such a way that we understand all we are being taught. If there is a question, he will take as much time as needed to teach us his truth. But if we want to unlock the truths the Bible contains, we must pick it up and begin to study it. God's Spirit is willing to teach us what we need to know, but first, we must make ourselves available to Him. Through the study of God's Word, we also learn the deeper things of God. It is one thing to know He loves us, but it is entirely different to realize that He has a plan for our lives. One of Satan's greatest lies is that we can do anything we want.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.